the word you hear that cleanses your mind. When your mind has been cleansed, your life is holy. If you are not taught who Christ is, you cannot live an effective Christian life. There is no other honor greater than that of sonship. Worldliness is the trap that enslaves men to the devil.
Relationship with God is a gift. Fellowship is a choice. The true expression of divine love is forgiveness to others. What you pursue is an expression of what you desire.
And he said to them, take heed and beware of covetousness. Beware what? Who is talking? The Lord Jesus. Take heed and beware of covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of the things he possesses. Please, who is saying this? Who is saying it? The Lord Jesus. Then he spoke a parable to them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man yielded plentifully. The ground yielded plentifully. And he thought within himself, what shall I do, since I have no room to store my crops? So he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barn, my storehouse, and build greater. And there I will store all my crops and my goods. Verse 19. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods laid up for many years. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. 20. But God said to him, fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Then whose will those things be which you have provided? Verse 21. So is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. Be rich towards God. Be rich towards God. That's the theme of the message. Be rich towards God. This is very important. Hallelujah. The Lord Jesus gave a parable and he said, before that he said, beware, take heed of covetousness, for a man's life does not consist of what he possesses. Listen to me. The value of a man is not determined by the material things he possesses. There is no material thing in this world that can add value to you. No one. Many of us have not understood that. So, we are deceived by the worldly standard. To go after these things, should we have them? Yes. Because of a purpose which I'll show you. But please be rest assured that there is nothing material in this world that can add any value to any man. Because the value of a man is his sacrifice that he has laid at the altar of the Lord. God weighs you by your sacrifice for him. Listen to what I'm saying. God weighs you by your sacrifice for him. So if you're that kind of a person that you're just living your life in here, just know there's a problem already. And beware, for a man's life does not consist of the things he has. Write this down. There is nothing material in this world that can add value to the identity of a man. Nothing. Stop trying to define yourself by your cars and your houses. That's not what God checks. There's something else God checks which I want you to see, and your eyes should be open to this when I'm preaching this morning. Beware. A man's life does not consist. If you read Job chapter 1, when the devil came to tempt Job, when God was speaking to Satan about Job, God said, have you seen my servant Job? Now, it is God who blessed Job with property. But God said, he's a man who fears me. A man who is righteous, a man who is blameless, a man who is upright. God gave four characteristics of Job. None was material. Then the devil said, does Job fear you for nothing? Have you not given him a house, children, build a hedge around him, increase his land, give him property. You look at that. So in the eyes of the world, we are identified by the content of our hand. But in the eyes of the Lord, we are identified by the content of our heart. So if I'm standing before God, I should not be deceived to think that what I have is of no value. I'm telling you the truth. Beware. For a man, this thing should enter your head and sink. A man's life does not consist in the abundance of the things he possesses. Tell you that your life, these things, is it does not consist of them. That's not how I should define my life. I should define myself. No, listen to what I'm saying now. It is your sacrifice for God that gives you weight in the realm of the spirit. In other words, your spiritual weight is determined by your sacrifice for God. I didn't say determined by attending church, by your sacrifice. There are men that have no spiritual weight because they have not registered themselves in the kingdom of God by the mystery of sacrifice. Are you following me? Father, grant us grace. So, when the Lord said that, he said, beware of covetousness. 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 What is covetousness? Uncontrollable desire for the things of the world that makes us to turn our heart from God in order to possess these things. Uncontrollable desire for the things of the world that makes us to turn our heart from the ways of God in order to possess the things of the world. That's covetousness. We can bribe to have a job. People can sleep with people to have a job. They are so much ready to have the things of the world that they can do anything, even doing what God hates, because they are going after the things of the world. So the fact that somebody is going to business with me, or covetousness comes when your desire for that thing is making you to depart from God. That's where it becomes covetousness. It is normal for you to have your business, to have your store. It is very normal. But when you realize that in the pursuit for those things, you are turning your heart from God, the proof that you are becoming covetous is that you can compromise your relationship with God for the pursuit of material gain. That's covetousness. You can do anything to have these material things. You are becoming covetous. That is a sign. When you can compromise your relationship with God for the pursuit of material gain, it is a sign that your heart is becoming covetous. Please, I plead with you. Be careful with your life. Be careful with your destiny. Many have been initiated into witchcraft because they are looking for money. People have killed their family members. Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. It is true that we need money. Yes, we need money. But the trouble is this. It is the way we meet our need for money that God checks. The need for money is correct, but the way we meet the need is what God checks. So when the Lord said to them, beware of covetousness, for a man's life does not consist in the abundance of the things he has, the people did not understand. So he gave them a parable. A parable is a short story with a familiar subject to teach an important lesson. So he had to use something which God, they were not understanding. What do you mean by our life does not consist? He said, let me give you a story. Because they were not spiritual, they were carnal, so they cannot understand the things of the spirit. So the only way he can teach them the things of the spirit is to use an earthly language. In a parable, we use an earthly language to describe a spiritual reality. You get the point? It's like when you used to be in nursery school, primary school, when the teacher would teach, after you would say a story. That story was to help our immature mind understand what he brought through the lesson. So So he now get the parable. So notice therefore that the purpose of this parable is to explain the instruction not to go after the things of the world. He said it clear. Do not seek what you shall eat. Now you write that. Do not seek what you shall wear. For the pagans run after such. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be what? Added to you. Now look at this. So a parable is using an earthly language to describe a spiritual reality. There are sometimes I can teach in church, then you see I will talk in Pidgin. What am I trying to do? I'm trying to make you really understand what I'm saying, because if you don't understand what I'm preaching, it cannot help you. Am I correct? Now, no matter what I preach, unless you understand, the message is unprofitable. It is your understanding of the word that makes it profitable to your life. That is why I always ask you, do you understand? Because I can talk big things, then you're not understanding. You say amen, fire, ride on, you have not understood. And what you don't understand, you cannot obey. What you don't understand, you cannot practice. Am I talking here? So it is your understanding of the word that makes it profitable to your life. The word I do not understand cannot profit me. So he now brought the parable and said, now there was a rich man whose ground yielded plenty. And we know that it is God that gives rain for ground to bring fruit. He said his farm yielded, and he was a rich man. Bible says he was a rich man. He was a rich man, and his ground yielded so much. So now, the man went and harvested and said, wow, all my storehouses, my cocoa storehouses are full. Why will I keep this my new harvest? Let me go and break my storehouse and build larger ones and store all my cocoa, store all my property there. I must store it there. And when I store it, I will say to my soul, eat, drink, relax. For many years, you have plenty of money. And God came. Can you imagine that God said, fool? God called him fool. God. The same Jesus that told us that call not anyone fool. God said, you fool. So what is foolishness? Foolishness is failing to acknowledge God as the source of your increase. But no matter which increase. Foolishness is failure to acknowledge God as the source of every increase in your life. That's better. The man says, I will say to my soul, you have worked hard, eat your money, drink. Pastor Mima, relax. It'll not be easy for my life. There are people who suffered more than you. They don't have what you have. If you have it, God has shown you mercy. I'm telling you the truth. It's time to recognize that God has helped you. God has helped you. Some of us, we like to complain, but God has helped us. God has helped us. Yes. God. Me, God has helped me. I cannot attribute the growth of this ministry to my prayer. I attribute the growth of this ministry to the grace of God. People have prayed more than me. Their church has not grown. It is grace. It's grace. Yes, you have been fighting with your husband. Fighting. People have not separated. Some people did not fight like you. Their own, they separated. So something, can't you see that something is keeping you? When we even look at it, when you hear that men who stand for God are dying and people who are careless are living, it opens your eye to know that there's something that is preserving you. That you are not alive by your righteousness. You are not alive by your strength. You are alive by his mercy and his grace. Yes. Something has preserved you. Something has kept you. Oh, I failed exam. Some of your classmates died. They didn't just fail. Something is keeping you. Foolishness also is denying the hand of God behind the good things that occur in our life. When you always want to attribute your success to, I read, I read, I direct. Oh, you don't know. You are being a fool. Psalms 14 verse 1. The fool says in his heart, there is no God. The fool. So you see a fool. See, what he has a PhD. There is no God. He's a fool. The fool says in his heart, there is no God. That's foolishness. Denying the hand of God behind the good occurrences in your life. That some things have happened. How many times do you say, thank you, sir? Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You are complaining, my children, my children, my children. Another woman does not have children. You have. They are giving you headache. At least you have that. Some women want children to come and give them headache. It's not there. There is so much ingratitude nowadays. One of the signs that you have spiritual foolishness is when you fail to give thanks to God. Every time Thanksgiving, every day is complain. Hey, can't you give thanks? God has helped you. I'm telling you. You have been having bad dreams. Some people had bad dreams one time. They woke up paralyzed. Your own, they will pierce you. They will cut your head. You are still here to today. Can't you see that something is keeping you? That's what I'm trying to make you understand. Stop taking life for granted, though. Yeah. You climb on the bike. You arrive safely. Thank God, though. Accident does not wait for special events to come. Some people took back just to go and buy tomato in the market, and they never came back. Thank God. All of you that are bike riders, we don't have to call for Thanksgiving for you. Because by reason of the work you do, you are facing daily risk of death. Those of you who are drivers, we don't have to call for Thanksgiving for you. Because your life is on the line every day. There is a hand keeping you. It's not your expertise. It's not that you are skillful. There is a hand. Do you know how many people have planned to kill you and they fail? Nobody say you are against sense. Na God. Na ye keep we. Na ye hele we. Na ye stand for our back. Even in the midst of our mistakes, things will turn bad. Then they turn again fine. Na God it will happen. God watches over your family. Watches over you. That man did not understand that the prosperity he enjoyed was provoked by the favor God released upon him. God must not come and tell you before you know that he's favoring you. God does not advertise his goodness. He just acts. Yes. You may be going for to have a job. God may not come and tell you or give you the job. You just go and have the job. But know that it is God. He's the one who did it for you. So the rich man, because he didn't hear God or see God, he thought that, well, who spoke to me? There's nobody that spoke to me. It should be my strength. I mean, my soul, you have worked. It's time to enjoy the fruit of your labor. God laughs. God said, you fool. This night you will die. This reminds us. Our life is in his hand. Foolishness is when you commit your soul to material things and not into the hand of the Lord. When you start thinking, Bible says, he said, a horse is a vain thing for the day of battle. It's when the man committed, he said, my soul, you have money, you can't have trouble. God said, I will show you that there's a dimension that money cannot enter. Money can attract a woman, cannot make her a wife. So if you have a wife, it must be God. Stop saying, if not of my money, will you have married me? You are carnal, my friend. No husband should talk like that. Even if you have 20 million, Somebody marry you, she's a wife. It can be money. Money can build a house, it cannot make it a home. Let me say, if not of my money, will not be comfortable now. Money does not bring comfort. Money can buy a car, it cannot buy a safe journey. Money can buy medicine, it cannot buy good health. Money can buy a bed, it cannot buy sound sleep. Money can buy food, it can't buy appetite. So when we realize that in any means, something good is happening. You say every good and perfect gift cometh from above. It is time to acknowledge that all I have is you, God. Sometimes in your house, just lie down. Sometimes the best thanksgiving is naked. I'm telling you, like David, naked in your room. He says, oh God, look at me and thank you, sir. Just to thank him. Why did this man die? Because he didn't understand the principle of thanksgiving. He died. I want to ask, he died. Because he couldn't say, thank you, my Lord. Thank you, my Jesus. Whatever I am now, it is by your grace. He couldn't sing that song. He said, no, whatever I am now, it is by my strength. God said, you fool, you are dying now. Every time when churches call for end of year thanksgiving, some carnal people think it is a means to raise finances for the church. They are stupid. Forgive my language. Stupidity is failure to acknowledge the truth. They think we are just saying thanksgiving. When the church needs money, we just say thanksgiving, everybody thanksgiving. They don't understand what we are doing. We don't want to end up like the rich fool. That's why we bring such things. All time thanksgiving, mid-year thanksgiving, end of year. What if we need thanksgiving all the time? It's because you don't understand, no, that by every kingdom principle, it is wrong to enter a new season without giving thanks for the previous season. It is wrong to enter even months. To enter, when you're entering a new month, you must give thanks for the previous month. That's why every first Sunday service, Sacred Day service, must be a service for thanksgiving for the previous month. But now, people who are carnal in their understanding, they think, now, I do not say it is true. Some people who call themselves, or people who God call, that because of misunderstanding, they have gone after financial gain. There are people like that who organize thanksgiving to have money. Yes, there are people like that. But the fact that there is counterfeit doesn't mean there is no true currency. But I'm telling you the truth today. Any real servant of God will tell you that thanksgiving is not a strategy to bring finances to the church. It is a means for people to sustain their growth in the Lord. That's not what we do thanksgiving. I cannot. Let me tell you something. Even the thanksgiving that I call is good, but it does not have power like the thanksgiving that you call. Thanksgiving, you must not come and dance in church. Sir, please, I'm coming to your office. I just want to thank God with this. Or you come to church, you call it yourself. So how can it? It takes humility to sit down by yourself and acknowledge that God has been good to you. I say, okay, I want to go and give thanks. So don't wait. We say the whole year. And people come and take envelope for 5,000, 365 days. That thanksgiving envelope is 5,000. We don't have trouble with that. Is that what God did for you that year? Or are you acting like this man? The man had an increase. There was no thought in his head to go and give tithes. There was no idea to go and give offering. There was no idea to go and give to the widow. He said, let me break my store, being a bigger one. Let me eat my money. My money. It's my labor. I work hard for it. So, when I just show up village, me or Wawa can't give you my money. Give them if you have sense. Then Jesus now spoke. He said, God said, you fool, you will die. Then Jesus said this verse, so shall it be done to you when you are not rich towards God. Now, that is a very dangerous prophecy. Jesus is saying that if you are not rich towards God, you provoke God to take his hand off your head. So this makes me understand that a man can be rich towards men and is not rich towards God. I told you that one time I was praying about and I mentioned the name of certain billionaires of our day, and God asked me, who are these men? I said, you don't know them. He said, I know them as human beings, but they are not rich. I wonder, these are people, I don't want to mention their names, that in the world that they are about, between the first 10 richest people, their names are there. But God said, he knows them as human beings, but the rich, they are not rich. Are you rich towards God? Or are you rich towards men? Now, the Lord Jesus opened our eye to a new dimension of God. So shall the Lord do for you when you are not rich. So what does it mean to be rich towards God? And how can I be rich towards God? I don't just want to be rich towards men. I want to be rich towards God. The man said to himself, my soul, I'm going to buy a new car. Covetousness. Somebody has 50 shoes. 100 dresses, 10 cars. With all due respect, certain men who call themselves prophets are being used by the devil to bring covetousness upon Christians, because all they display and demonstrate is material gain, not godliness. So Christians come to church and they are hungry to have cars, not hungry to be holy, not hungry to stop sleeping with a married man. They are hungry to have a jet. They are hungry to build story buildings. They are not thirsty for righteousness. Blessed are those that hunger for what? For righteousness. So we must be careful. I must constantly check my life in the dimension of holiness. Why? Because as your pastor, I must make sure, me, Kevin, that I am turning your heart to the Lord, not to the world. I must make sure that no matter what happens, I should see you in heaven. I must make sure. Even if sometimes I will preach, some people will be offended. That cannot be my intention. But if you will take that offense to deliver you from the worldliness you are in, no trouble. Until you understand the value of holiness, the value of righteousness, that we can't just come to church on Sunday in the evening, we go and get drunk. We come back again to church. Saturday night, we cannot be in bars and nightclub, dancing and drinking. On Sunday, we come and lift our hands. Until we understand that these days, we cannot serve. That is not service to God. Those times were times of ignorance. Not in the days when God has raised men and given them understanding of the truth in the scripture to open your eye. That is not the lifestyle that pleases God. That we can't come and lift their hands in the morning and dance and jump, and in the evening, somebody is fornicating. We cannot live like that. Why? We are Christians. What the world expects to see in the church, it's not money, it's holiness. The world has money. Should the church have money? Yes. But that's not what we show to the world. We must show the world what they don't have. The only thing that the church can have that the world cannot have is righteousness, godliness, holiness. If it is power, they have power. They are witch doctors that perform miracles. They prophesy. I'm telling you. They call people's name. They see their problem. They cut somebody's stomach. 30 years barren. She got pregnant. Cut her. Put in there. She got pregnant. So what then are we doing that they are not doing? It must be holiness. That when they look, they can do those miracles as well, but they cannot have that lifestyle. That's where we beat them. Are you with me, child of God? He said, be rich towards God. Now, let's see that verse 21 again. Luke 12, verse 21. So is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. So we must be rich towards who? Towards who? Towards who? Towards God. was God number one. But let me just explain. The only way to be rich towards God is through giving. There's no other way. It's not through prayer. Giving is the kingdom principle in order to become rich towards God. Giving is the kingdom principle in order to become rather than giving is the kingdom principle in order to become rich towards God. There is nothing else you can do. You cannot pray and become rich towards God. It's by reason of your giving. It's by reason of your giving. If you must be rich towards God, it's giving. Remember what I said before? I said that your spiritual weight is determined by what? Your sacrifice. Yes, sacrifice. Your sacrifice. So, giving is what? Friend, the Lord Jesus said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Why should he say that? It's very powerful. I'd like you to understand that God gives money for a reason. The Lord Jesus said, use money to make yourself friends. Listen to me. This money you see, money is earthly. It's earthly. But through money, you can have spiritual weight in heaven, in the eyes of God, through money. Money is earthly. But the way you use money given to you, you can enter dimensions in heaven that others will not enter through prayer. That's the scripture. We'll see it. So, it is what? Giving. Number one, we must give to God. Show me Luke 21, verse 1 to 4. And he looked up and saw the who? Notice, the rich putting their gift into the treasury. Verse 2. And he also saw a certain poor widow putting in two mites. Verse 3. So he said, truly I say to you, that this poor widow has put in more than all. Verse 4. Now here. For all these out of their abundance have put in offering for God. But she, out of her poverty, put in all the livelihood that she had. Now watch. The Lord Jesus, now listen to me. Follow. Anything that attracts the attention of the Lord Jesus is very important in the eyes of God. Don't forget what I'm saying. He sat down and he was watching people giving offering. He was watching offering time, looking at them. And shockingly, he was checking what everybody was giving. Jesus was, he was looking. 5,000, 10,000, 20,000, 50,000. Then somebody gave 200. He said, Peter, come. He said, see this one, this woman I gave 200? She has given more than all. So offering is not equal in the eyes of God. It's not equal. She said, in the language of men, her offering is the least. But in the language of the Spirit, her offering is the greatest. So how can 200 have more weight than 20,000? Sacrifice has more weight. Now, look at this. Something shocked me here. The Lord Jesus said, she has given all that she had to live on. If it is us, you see, he's a bad pastor. He would have told the woman, take your offering and go. She gave her last, yet God said, leave it there. So, asking people not to give offering is not pity. It's not even wisdom. It's not even right. Unless instructed by God. If somebody is bringing his last 50 francs, put it in the offering basket. Sometimes, when we try to, because when the world of insult us, we try to maybe to balance it, say, no, you must not give offering. You must give offering. It's scriptural. She came to give offering, and the Lord specified that this woman is giving what her life depends on. Yet, he didn't ask her to take it back. Somebody is owing half rent, and is coming to give his land money. God said, give it. It's not because God is greedy. God knows that the only principle to get to access grace. greater dimensions of financial wealth is to give. He knows that if he tells that woman, take back your offering and go, she will die at that particular level. But if he allows her put it there, she has provoked a reward from God. She's becoming rich toward God, and God must reward her. Have you not read 1 Kings chapter 17? Elijah went to the house of a widow and said, give me food. She says, the last. She said, give me the last. It's not wickedness, please. You must give to God. Offering and tithes, we must give to God. Malachi 3, 6 to 10. He said, bring the full offering and the tithe. You don't give tithes to be blessed. You give tithe because you have been blessed. Give your offering. Now, I want to show you this, that in the whole scripture, one of the things that caught the attention of God was offering. The Bible says he sat down and looked at people. With his busy schedule, he took time, he watched offering time. Offering time, he started looking. And he was checking money. He said, this woman has given much more. This thing showed me that offerings are not equal in the eyes of God. But he also proved to me that the weight of your offering is determined by the sacrifice of the giving. If I have 10,000, I come and give my 2,000. And somebody has 2,000 and gives 1,500, before God, he has given more than me. Yes. When it comes to tithes, nobody can give tithe more than another person. Because when you give tithe, God does not quantify tithe by amount. He quantifies tithe by percentage. Tithe is 10%. If I give 1 million, no, you give 10,000. In the eyes of God, it's 10% all of us. So it is now offering that God check. Are you with me? You must give to God. When it's time to give to God, don't allow the devil confuse your mind, telling you, you are giving this one, how will you do after? The God I am giving to, is he able to provide for me? Cast your cares upon the Lord, for he cares. So wait, how do you cast your cares? You know the meaning of the word cast? How do you cast your cares? You cast your cares upon the Lord by giving to him in times of need. That's what it means. It's not by praying. You cast your cares upon the Lord by giving to him in times of need. Cast your cares, give to him, and he will reward you. He will sustain you. He will bear your burden. Oh, this man, I just have money now. Can God, did he not feed 5,000 men? Can he not take care of you? But notice, before Jesus made the miracle to feed 5,000 men, he said, look for somebody with something. A boy came with 5 loaves of bread. It was everything that boy had. If it is in our days, we will say that the prophet is wicked. People are hungry and you take a child's last food. Because it's bread and fish. 5 bread, 2 fish. Maybe it was a family food. He took it. Is that no wickedness in your eye? Not gonna prove that. Instead of a prophet of a gear and put it, he said, take from them. If the prophet does not take from them, he cannot provoke heaven to give to them. It is a law. Learn it, that is a law. You must give to God. From now, I want to encourage you. Change your offerings. Don't treat offering casually. I can even assure you that God is more interested in your offering than your prayer. Because you pray because you have a need, you give because you love. And everything born of love attracts the attention of God. You are praying for, Lord, give me a job. Lord, give me a house. Is it what you want? But when it comes to offering time, you are giving from your heart. For God so loved the world that he gave. So giving is an expression of love, an expression of value. Honor the Lord with your substance and with the increase of your business. Proverbs 3 verse 9. So giving is an expression of love to God, of love, of honor, and of trust. When you give to God, you are expressing your love. You are demonstrating your honor for him. And you are demonstrating your trust in him. I love him. I honor him. I trust him. In Malachi chapter 1 from verse 5 to 8, the Lord was angry with the offering people gave. He said, people come to our church and give blind goat as offering. God was angry. He said, how can you take your bike and take the transport, the pay bike, take the change and come and give? God was angry. He was angry with the offering. He said, how can you offer me this kind of offering? And God said, he said, when you go to your governor, this is not what you offer. Why do you offer this to me in my temple? So the way we give offering matter, the kind matter, don't just come anyhow. Understand what I'm preaching this morning, please. What you give is very important. Very important. Don't give anyhow. Prepare yourself to offer. No, as I repeat, God is interested in your offering. Number two, we must give to the work of God. Show me Mark chapter 10, verse 29. So Jesus answered and said, as surely I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brother or sister or father or mother or wife or children or land for my sake and the gospel, verse 30, who shall not receive a hundredfold now in this time, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and land with persecution, and in the age to come eternal life. What's something there? You must give to the work of God. The second way to be rich towards God is to give to his work. If there is a crusade, that is not offering, that is not tithe. Giving to the work of God is not offering. You know, in the Old Testament, there were many offerings. Free will offering, sacrifice offering. Giving to the work of God is not offering. It's sacrifice. It is not offering. Offering. That's why we can come in church, we take offering and tithe. Then after we say there is a crusade, you come and give. That is sacrifice. It has weight. Even more than what you give on Sunday during worship or Saturday during worship. It has much more weight. Are you following me, child of God? You must give to the work of God. Listen to me. Every opportunity to give to the work of God is an opportunity to be lifted in life. Never ever withhold your finances when the work of God is stranded. When you see a pastor being driven out of his church because of rents, and you have the money, I'm your pastor, I will never deceive you. Even if it's not me, pay the rent. Just tell me, sir, I've seen this thing, pay. Before you pay, tell me so I can pray with you. Pay. I can assure you, you will notice a dimension of God will raise you. That you are hearing, you are not worshiping there, and you may never worship there. But every time you hear that the work of God is strong, you hear, okay, some people came to have a crusade in your village, and in the crusade ground, the speakers got burnt. Nobody should tell you. Very fast, go and hire a speaker. Don't even speak about, you are not in the crusade, you will not even attend the crusade, but you cannot be quiet when the work of God is stranded. You move for it. A church has a TV channel, they don't pay bills, they cut them off. Why am I not seeing TV again? They cut it off. I will pay. I don't have much money. I have just part. I have just 20,000. Add to what you have. God, that is sacrifice. God sees that. And God says, this man is rich towards me. He's rich towards me. It provokes God to usher you to greater realms. So you can't be quiet when the work of God is stranded. You can't sit down and watch things happen that bring shame to God's work. Are you with me? I'm seeing a pastor preaching on the road, and the pastor is shouting at the back every day, repent. How much is megaphone? I'll buy it for him. I don't know him. I don't even want to know him. He's doing the work of God. I want to be rich towards God. So it's an opportunity to be rich. It's an opportunity to put more money in my financial account, because there's a financial account. Do you know there's a financial? Do you know there's a spiritual account? Show me Philippians 4:19. All right, verse 20. Now, to our God and Father, take from verse 8, from verse 17. He says, not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that abounds to your account. You see, he says, Paul said, support me. And he told them, it's not just because, yes, it's true, I need the support. But also, it is because I want you to put something in your spiritual account. That if I say, we have a conference next week, who wants to give? I am giving you opportunity to put something in your spiritual account. In the whether you or your family, one day there will be a need. And when you pray, from that account, there will be a provision to you. Some people pray, heaven has nothing in the account to answer them. Because they are not rich towards God. Number three, you must give to the house of God. To what? Show me Luke chapter 7 verse 1 to 5. Now, when he concluded, he said, in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum, verse 2. And a certain centurion, whose servant was dear to him, was sick and ready to die. Verse 3. So when he heard about Jesus, he sent elders of the Jews to him, pleading with him to come and heal his servant. Now, this time, Jesus was not sent to the lordship, only to Israelites. Hear what? And when they came to Jesus, they begged him earnestly, saying that the one for whom he should do this was deserving. Verse 5. For he loves our nation and has built us a synagogue. Because of that, he deserved a miracle. You see why your account needs to have something? When there was a problem, the pastor said, sir, this man, he is rich towards God. He deserved the miracle. Can I shock you? And Jesus left. The man told Jesus to speak a word. Jesus said, I'm coming to your house. Why? He was deserving. He has built a synagogue. Friend, you are passing in your quarter that being a church. Buy one bag cement, drop there and pass. It's not only about your own church. Forget this. This is kingdom of God, not church. We need to fight and fight. Anytime you see there's a house of God, put your hand, send your hand, put something. God has blessed us. At least now, we are in a particular dimension. At least look at where we are. God has blessed us. Not every person is like this. So I encourage you as members here that we should also stand for other churches to be raised to be at least to this kind of dimension where they have not too much pain. Yes, we have needs, but not like me. People have 10 times more need than us. So you are passing. You see them, they are building a church. They are using a plank to build it. Say, how much is this plank? Okay, I don't have money. I'm giving 50,000. Hey, it is important to give into the house of God. Now, this is not for the work. This is not for the gospel. This is for the house of God to stand. Show me Haggai chapter 1. We'll take from verse 1 to verse 11. It's a lot of scriptures. In the second year of King Darius, in the sixth month, go to verse 2. Thus speaks the Lord of hosts, saying, these people says, the time has not come. The time that the Lord's house should be built has not come. They were saying that God's time has not come to build his house. Verse 3. Then the word of the Lord came, saying, verse 4. Is it time for you yourself to dwell in your panel houses? You know panel? You know the panel houses? You know Amako? Yes. So you build your house, you put Amako. Then God says, is it time for you to dwell in your panel houses? And this temple lie in ruins. Therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Verse 6. You have sown much and you bring in little. You eat but do not have enough. You drink but you are not filled with drink. You clothe yourself but you are not warm. And he who earns wages to put into a bag with hole. Verse 7. Thus says the Lord again, consider your ways. Verse 8. Go up to the mountain and bring wood and build a temple that I may take pleasure in it and be glorified. Ha! We'll just leave it there. God said, build my house. Paint it. Beautify it. Let me be glorified. So God wants to take pleasure in his house. Because it's her. So you are building your story building. When they come to church, it's carabot. God says, okay, you will see. He says, I will blow what you carry. I will close the heaven. If you earn a wages, you put it by the back that has hold. You will keep losing until you go and build my house. Let me be glorified. Some of you don't understand. Why is it that twice a year I paint this church? Listen to me. I want to show you the way to follow God. Not just by preaching, but by my character. All the pastors who are under me, I want to show them the way to serve God. Painting this entire church is a lot of money, but I do this twice every year. I want to show them that you do not despise the house of God. Every time you come here, you will see it clean. You will see it neat. You will see a kind of order. I'm not stupid. I invest a lot of money to do all these things you see here. I want it to be beautiful. And by the grace of God, I'm trying that it should be better all the time. Why? He says, build my house. Let me take pleasure and be glorified. In other words, if you build the house of God and it is not nice, he does not take pleasure in it. He says, do it well. See this place up there? I'm already praying, working on that, because we have to cover it. Let it be the best. People beat their heart, they don't leave roof like this. They cover the roof. I'm sure you have to be rich towards God. The house of God. Do not neglect the house of God. You come in church, you pass outside, you see death. Let me say, there's death everywhere. Go to the market, buy a trash can, put in church. How much is trash can? Is it up to 3,000? Buy four, put it. Do something. Sanitation, please. Can I buy you poor rags? Can I buy you rakes? Can I buy you soap? Can I do something? No matter how small, even if say you are poor, you can buy Omo for 100. So you are not poor. You are simply selfish or you are ignorant. You are not poor. And this is a problem. That money you keep putting in the things of the world, in the day of calamity, the world will answer you, not the Lord. Because you prefer to take all your money and put in your phone, put here. When you put your money in a bank, now the economy has frozen. You have lost millions. What will you do now? By which you will have put it in a spiritual account, no matter what happened, in the day of trouble, there will always be a provision because you have done something for the house of God. This is what you must do. Sometimes you just come to church, just look around. What can I do here? All right. I don't have much money, but I have 10,000. What can I buy for 10? Okay, let me buy a clock. Nothing is small. I'm telling you that nothing is small. Nothing is small. Look at these scriptures that we put there. Imagine you buy and we put in the whole church. Scriptures like that. This is how you should be reasoning. Listen to me. Kevin is not only a pastor. I'm a leader. I want to show you how to follow God. So I must show you by my lifestyle. I will not preach how what I don't live. No. I want that when you come to this church, don't only hear what I preach. Look at the way I'm doing things. Everything I'm doing is a message to you people. So you come every, at least this is a new year. What can the family do for the house of God? It's not all the time. You must not ask me all the time. You can come and just look and say, I think we should put tithes in the whole church. Okay, I don't have money for that. Let me start small. Let us start putting tithes in this choir side. We move small. Hey, and God sees that. And God says, this person wants my house to be beautiful. I will make his life beautiful. Number four, you must give to servants of God. Show me Luke chapter 10, verse 5 to 7. But whatever house you enter, first say what? Peace to this house. Verse 6. And if there is a son of peace is there, your peace will rest on it. If not, it will return to you. Now notice how you know a son of peace. Verse 7. And remain in the same house, eating and drinking such things as they give. For the laborer is worthy of his wages. Do not go from house to house. Yet we got the talk. He said, evangelist, pastor, don't be going from house to house that you are hungry. Go to this house and say, I will stay here. It's there. So pastor should not be staying in hotel. He said, look for a house. Enter there. If the person is worthy, how does he prove the person is worthy? The person gave to you. He gave to you. He said, say peace to the house. That's how a pastor enter. Peace to this house. Don't say amen. Bring water very fast. I'm teaching you how to respond. He says, if you enter and you say peace to the house, if they are saying amen, he said, go you back. But if they bring you something to eat and drink, stay. Now, I am shocked that Jesus sent people to preach, yet he asked them to be eating. No, I thought they should be praying and fasting. This is Jesus talking. He said, eat and drink. For you people, it's carnality. For you people, prophet is a langa man. That's true. But Jesus, he said, stay there. Eat, drink. It is correct. You are bringing them blessing, and you are my servant to do the work. No, the thing that I told that prophets are not spirits. They are just men that by grace walk with God. But there's flesh. They have flesh and bone. This flesh and bone have needs. Those who stand up to meet them, God can never forget them. First, please sit down. First Kings chapter 17 from verse 5. It talks how Elijah went to the house of the widow. In fact, Bible said there was a famine. There was what? And God said, Elijah, go to the house of a widow. I have commanded her to feed you. A widow. How can God command a widow to feed a prophet? Imagine that today. How can a man of God be going and taking money from a widow? Imagine what the Bible people say today. Elijah went to the widow's house. She said, I have my last food. He said, give me first. Is that not wickedness to us? It was not wickedness. It's a spiritual law. He said, give me first. And they gave him. He said, from today, your child will never run dry. What? From the woman's spiritual account, it was filling her physical account. Simple. Please sit down. When that woman, a Shunammite woman, saw Elisha passing, she said, my husband, let us bring the man of God to eat in our house. He came and ate and drank. Then she said, my husband, let us build him a house. One of the greatest things you can do for a pastor, a church can do for their pastor, is to build him a house. Why? Because of establishment in the place of honor. One of the, if you check where, the secret of churches that prosper so much, like Catholic and Press, if it, their pastors are not fighting house rent with anybody, if they build a church, they, come on. When Catholic is building, at the same time they are building, the father's house is being built. Presbyterian, as they are building, unless they want, as they are building, the house is there. No Presbyterian pastor, the landlord come and ask him, pay hard and not pay hard. It can never happen to them. Unless he wants to go and stay in somewhere else. Which even if he goes, maybe the church will still pay. They don't play. One of the greatest things you can do for your pastor is to build him a house because of the honor he needs. The same way you build a house for the Lord. She built a room for Elisha. Elisha said, she, first of all, she was giving food and drink. He didn't bless her. There are blessings that come for food, but it's a blessing. If somebody come and give land to pastor, sir, this is for you to be your house. When you listen to me, when you already have that idea that pastor needs a house, God start blessing you. God knows that this man is truly, you truly care. And Elijah told the woman, you have shown me this care. You look at the giving. Why the giving is important is because you have shown care to your pastor who shows you care. Some people don't know that thing, that pastor needs care. You have to give to servants of God. Above all, you must be giving that pastor that is above you, give to him. Listen, if I'm your pastor, but you want to give to me, don't be afraid. Don't, that is like, yes, you want to come and give me 10 million. I'm entering my account to give the prophet. Don't forget, they are giving to the man who sacrificed his life for you. In fact, is it Philemon or Philippians when Paul said the people owe him their own life? He said, you people owe me your life. Because what happened? One of Paul's pastor was owing somebody. And Paul said, the debt my pastor had put on me, not forgetting that all of you in this church, you owe me your life. Bible talker. That's the voice of the Holy Spirit. Give. When is it? I don't mean give away the game because you get problem. Now, selfish giving that. When trouble comes, you run. This seed is to open heavens. Can't you give when the heavens are already open? Can't you be fine and remember me also that, Pastor, well, let me go and see the prophet. Pastor, prophet, I came to see you. I have a little gift for you. I just have this for you. Thank you. God knows that. But no, you remain like that. Things are tight, things are bad. Or you are going to embassy. You now run now and bring seed. As long as you keep tying your giving to your needs, you will have a blessing, but not a great blessing. Or you will be blessed, but you will never become a blessing. You must tie it to your care, to your love for your pastor. Sir, it's not because I have a problem. I just wanted to give to you. Remember your pastor now. Give him now. Are you blessed? Are you sure? Number 5. Give to the needy. Show me Proverbs 19 verse 17. He who has pity on the poor lends to the Lord. and the Lord will pay back what he has given. So you can borrow money to God. How? Give to the poor. The Bible talks about this. Have you ever read this in the Bible? Give me many versions of this scripture. If you help the poor, you are lending to the Lord and he will repay you. Malabaya. Just go to one orphanage, give them 2 bags of rice. You are lending to the Lord. Don't give the bag of rice and begin to snap. Then they snap the bag of rice. Then you laugh. You say, we don't have much, but we have to give. The Bible says you have lost your reward. You have lost it. Give it and stay quiet. Let the orphanage go and put you on Facebook. Not you. You have given. You are doing business with God, not with men. So you can borrow money you can borrow God some money. I feel like lending God some money. I just go to one orphanage. With interest, that's true. God will pay with interest. I say, Lord, this money I'm giving you 20 back, but give me 50. I mean, it's bank now. We must put interest rate. I said, the interest rate of this man give you is 2%. So I go to one orphanage, I just give them 100,000. He shall repay. God is not unrighteous to forget your labor of love. He shall repay. You give to God, you give to his work, you give to his house, you give to his servant, you give to the poor. He said, God cannot forget your labor of love. Hebrews 6:10. God cannot forget. It will speak for you, it will speak for your children. I'm blessed. Why am I blessed? I am blessed to know some certain principles. My children will never suffer. Never. Because I know what to do as a father. Never. 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 This is the secret. Me, no matter what happens, I will never suffer. Never in my life. Because I've known the way I must be reached towards God. In all the points I put, did I put prayer? Did I put fasting? So be wise. Giving. God is not unrighteous to forget our labor of love. Rise on your feet.